Lord, we're living in dangerous times. We need you more than ever. We need your strength. We need your wisdom. And Lord, as we open our hearts, we ask you to come in and strengthen us for this journey. We ask it, Lord, that we would gather together and be able to lift our hearts up unto you. You know the world we're in. You know the dangers that we're in. And we know, Lord, that many times we don't have the strength. Lord, we pray that you would give us the strength and you would give us the wisdom in this present age. Lord, lift us up. Hold us close. And Father, we pray for our nation as it faces such danger. Oh, never as before in this world, in this country, have we suffered this way and are looking forward to more. We can only go through, Heavenly Father, if you're with us. And you're giving us your strength and your wisdom for the journey. Pray for our pastor. Lord, that you would anoint him from on high. And Lord Jesus Christ, you would lift him up. And as he speaks today, it would not be his voice, but it would be the voice of Jesus Christ. And so we ask this in your presence, we ask you in this time, and we thank you so much. We ask it in your name. Amen.
Amen. Oh, sing the wondrous love of Jesus. Sing his mercy and his grace. In the mansions bright and blessed, he'll prepare for us a place.
It's when we all
get to heaven. What a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. While we walk the pilgrim pathway, clouds will overspread the sky. But when traveling days are over, not a shadow, not a sign. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. Jesus, we'll sing and shout victory. Let us then be true and faithful, trusting, serving every day. Just one glimpse of him in glory will a toil of life repay. When we all get to heaven, rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory.
Amen. Come on, turn out.
Onward to the prize before us. Soon his beauty will behold. Soon the pearly gates will open. We shall tread the street of gold.
When we all
get to heaven.
Say it like you mean it.
What a day of rejoicing that will be.
Praise God.
When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory.
It's when we all
get to heaven.
Yes, Lord.
What a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory.
One more time.
When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory.
One more time.
That's when we all get to heaven. What a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory.
Shout the victory.
New joy for a new day. And Mark 14, 20 through 25 is where we'll be looking into God's Word. And I want you to get this fact and get it embedded into your spirit and your mind and your heart. Jesus is the name above every name. There is no doubt about it. That name is above every name. And whatever you're going through, whatever you're facing, whatever you're encountering in life, still that name is above everything. Above every dark night, above every problem, every challenge, everything that you will face in life, that name, Jesus, say that name, Jesus, say that name, Jesus. Come on, say it loud and proud. That name, Jesus, is above every name. Today we come again to the Gospel of Mark, and we once again are continuing in chapter 14. We've landed in Mark 14, and there we find some things that God has placed before us. He will use a meal to define the meaning of his death. Have we forgotten, and do we become careless in the cross, in Christ, in the death, in the blood, in the burial, in the resurrection? Has it just become commonality to us? Well, that's a part of it. Or does it have really deep-seated, grounded meaning in your life? He came to give his life that we could have eternal life in his presence forevermore. I take that serious. Because without Jesus, there is no eternal life in heaven. Without Jesus, there's no hope. Without Jesus, there's no forgiveness of our sins. He has made us, listen, he has made us acceptable to the Father. He has opened the gate. He has opened the door. He has made the way, as he said in John 14, 6. He is our way. He is our truth. He is our life. However, if your acceptance is in the world, then today the question would be, where's Jesus in your life? Too many of us are seeking acceptance in the world and identification in the world and the ways of the world. Listen today. The old songwriter wrote, "You can take this whole world, but give me Jesus." And I believe that is really the crucial mark of our lives. So we find today in the Last Supper, the Lord's Supper, we see the bread, we see the cup. And what we're going to do today, we're going to see the bread and the cup speaking to our hearts and our lives. The blood of Jesus is the new covenant. The new covenant means the new promise. And I'm glad that we have a promise book called the Bible. And I'm glad that we have a promise keeper that sits on the throne. And his name is Almighty God. And all that is available through Jesus Christ, the only begotten of the Father. So in the new covenant, God makes a way for mankind. And he does it by faith and not by works. We're not saved by works. We're saved by grace. For by grace are you saved through faith and not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. So therefore today, by believing and not by performance. You don't perform to get God's acceptance or God's attention. You come humbly. You come in humility. You come broken. You come spit out. But thank God, I'm glad he can take the fragments of our life and put them back together and use us mightily for his kingdom. Give the Lord a praise in the house. Mark 14, it's Passover. During the Passover celebration, the Lord takes the elements of the Passover, and what he does, he takes those elements and he transforms them. They will speak of his soon death. Yes, death. Jesus would die, but you know what's amazing about this? Even before this world was framed, even before there was Adam and Eve, God saw the cross. Right down through the pages of the Old Testament, and the sacrifices and the things that were done in the tabernacle, and all the events that would happen, we find God saw the cross. The cross shattered everything from the beginning, where he says, in the beginning God created the heaven and the earth. God shattered the pages of his word with the cross. And so the Lord's Supper, it becomes a treasured part of the church. We are the church. It's not, the church is not the pews and the mortar and the bricks and the temple or the steeple, but it's the people. We are the church of the living God. So it reminds us of his sacrificial death, where Jesus died in our place. He took the shame that was against us. He took our sins. He took all the shackles that had us entwined. And in the text, we see this is the night Jesus would even be betrayed by Judas Iscariot. This is the night he would be arrested. Wednesday is past. It's Thursday. And now it's just hours away from his arrest and even his crucifixion. This is the night that he will face a marked trial. Then on Friday, Jesus would face the cross. You know what's so amazing about that? He faced the cross for you and I. He took the wrath of God that was against us, and he took that wrath upon himself, that you and I today could go free. And whom the Son sets free is free indeed. Amen. 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 So the Last Supper, the cross, is just not a religious picture. And what a travesty that was done recently in Paris in the parody. And what they did is a mockery to God. Let me tell you what, Judgment Day is going to be very intense for some. Amen. That is the reason that I never watched any of the Olympics, had no desire to. After that, I was done with it. Amen. I will not embrace, I will not condone, I will not support, and I will not stand up for any of the ways of the world. I will only stand up for the cross, the Christ of the cross, and the redemption that he has made for you and I today. Amen. But we realize, you've got to remember, the cross is not the end. Amen. Some still have Jesus on the cross. Some still have him in a tomb. Let me tell you what, he is alive. Amen. He is seated at the right hand of God the Father. He is our intercessor, our provider. He's the one that loves us. He's the one that died for us. And he's the one that's due all of our praise, thanks, and glory today. Amen. For this is a fact. The cross changes everything. Amen. Let's move to the text. Mark 14, 22 through 25. The word of God says, and as they did eat, Jesus took bread and blessed and broke it and gave it to them and said, take, eat, this is my body. And he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them. They all drank of it. And he said unto them, this is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for many. Verily or truly, I say unto you, I will drink no more of the fruit of the vine until that day that I may drink it new in the kingdom of God. May God add the blessing to the reading of his word. Let me take you back some years to England. Lady Jane Grey served as the Queen of England for 9 days. She served 9 days before Mary Tudor, or more known as Bloody Mary, put Lady Jane Grey in the Tower of London and finally had her head cut off. Jane was only 18 years old. She was raised a Protestant. The problem at that time, there was a conflict between Catholicism and the Protestant church. Several days before Lady Grey's death, a priest was sent to to inform her if she would convert, she would not die. The Catholic Church believed the bread and the wine, they still today, believed the blood and the wine turned into actual flesh and blood of Jesus. They call it the Eucharist, and they keep it in a safe place. They put that blood and that bread in a safe place there for the next time they have communion. Lady Jane was asked by the priest, didn't she believe in the sacrament she received, actually the body and the blood of Jesus? Lady Jane Gray stated she did not believe that. She said when receiving communion, she was put, listen carefully, into remembrance of the shedding of the blood of Christ on the cross for her sins. That act would lead to the martyrdom of several hundred people during the reign of Bloody Mary. Now, every one of those killings centered around this text in the book of Mark. In the Last Supper, or the Lord's Supper, as it is called, we find it is Passover week. Now, Passover was a celebration of God bringing the Israelites out of captivity in Egypt and bringing them into what we know as the Promised Land. The Passover celebrated in looking forward to even the cross of Jesus. There again is a picture, a shadow of the cross. And today we look back to the cross. Not today from the standpoint of being there. Our sins were there. But let me tell you, we look back at the cross today, and what Jesus is doing, he is establishing a new covenant for you and I. And thank God for that today. So when we take the Lord's Supper, it reminds us of what our theme declares. Jesus, he makes all things new. Aren't you glad of that? Amen. Hallelujah. I'm glad he made all things new in my life. The day that I called upon him in free pardon of sin, wretched, blind, and going to hell, but I cried out, Lord, have mercy on my soul. And his blood blotted out the redemption that I needed and gave me hope. He blotted out every sin, every shackle, everything that was against me. And redemption took a hold of my life and redeemed me. And I'll tell you, here it is in 2024, and I'm still saved by the glory of God, and I shall be saved forever by his grace. Amen. Let me just insert a little thought here to you today. If you have the thought and the persuasion that you can lose what Jesus has given you today in salvation, you are believing wrong. The blood settles it. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Not plus anything, not minus anything, and you cannot do anything to lose what God has birthed in your spirit today. And the church said, Amen. That's a wonderful thought. Jesus makes all things new. Maybe you need that today. Maybe you've never come to the cross. Maybe you've never accepted him as your Savior. I want you to know today, his arms are open, and his reception is, if you'll come, he shall receive you. Now, they're at the table, and they're going to eat the bread. This was unleavened bread that was eating. They had to eat it when they left Egypt in haste, because they were there under bondage, and God had made a means and a way of escape. So Jesus takes the bread, and it changes the meaning. And I'll show you why. When he said, I am the bread, it was actually a metaphor. You know, understand, I thought about this. If a Catholic church today believes that every time they take communion, they're literally taking of the body and the blood of Jesus, then what do they do about when Jesus says, I am the door? Jesus said, I am the way. I am the truth. I am the life. That bread that you will receive today And that wine that you will drink, the grape juice, is representative of the body and the blood of Jesus. It represents what he has done for you and I. Oh, what a price he paid. He gave it all. And we should be willing to give him our life today. Understand, the bread was broken, but the body of Jesus was not broken on the cross. We talk about Jesus having his body broken. That is not correct. Because when Jesus was crucified and they came to break his legs to go ahead to finalize death, he was already dead. He did not die with anything broken. The only thing Jesus had was a broken heart for sinners. And to go to that cross and to die there represents the love that he has for you and I today. Greater love hath no man than this, that a man named Jesus would lay down his life on the cross for you and I. Oh, isn't that wonderful? Amen. Thank you, Lord. Amen. That's something to get excited about. That's something to praise God about today. So the wine, it symbolizes his blood that would be poured out as a crimson river rolling and flowing down from Mount Calvary, Golgotha's hill, giving life to all who will believe. This is pointing to the cross, pointing to the cross where the blood of Jesus would be shed for all mankind. The blood is shed, and is shed for many, Jesus said. And he also said this, and I love this. Some churches teach you've got to do this or that. You've got to be baptized, or you've got to believe a certain way, or you've got to be slain, or you've got to speak in tongues and all this in order to go to heaven. Let me tell you, that is scripturally wrong. Jesus says, all that will come to me, I will in no wise cast out. There's only one entrance. There's only one way. There's only one Savior. And that way is through him today. In verse 25, we find the hope that is there for you and I. For Jesus makes all things new. Let's go over several things. I only have 3 points for you today. And you ought to say amen to that.
Amen.
But in the first point, there are 8 sub-points. But bear with me, they'll go quickly. Amen. First, there is life in Jesus. I found 4 truths and 4 promises. Those are those 4 points, bullets. Truth number 1, incarnation. Jesus was born physically. He actually lived in a physical body like yours and mine. He felt pain. He knew agony. He went through emotional drain. He had and felt everything that you and I feel in life. So he is, as Isaiah said, the man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. He feels what you feel. He's been through what you're going through. He lived his life, though, in a sinless body, a body such as yours and mine. And this is important, for we sin in our bodies. We're sinners, and we sin in our bodies. And so listen, we're not saved outside of his sinless life. It's only through his sinless life are we saved. There's not a church on this earth. There's not a preacher, priest, nor rabbi, or any other people who proclaim to be religious. Religion doesn't save you. Religion is man's way to try to get into the kingdom of God. We're saved by redemption, atonement, by his substitute, of him giving his life. Good works, good deeds won't get you there. Only through the blood. Only through the crimson, royal, red blood of Jesus. Amen. He takes our sinful lives, and through his physical death on the cross, he offers salvation to every person. We're given imputed righteousness. Thank God. Truth number 2, crucifixion. Jesus bore our sins in his body on the tree. His body was real. It really bled, and he really suffered. He suffered in the court when he was beaten with a cat of 9 tails, 39 lashes. His body ripped apart, flesh just in shreds. He was a bloody mess, weak, worn, beaten, ridiculed, and mocked. Truth number three, resurrection. Thank God it did not end at the cross. For after his death, his body was placed in the tomb of Joseph of Arimathea. Jesus was a dead body. His body was exhausted of any life. But, oh hallelujah, but on that third day, God the Father reached down and raised up Jesus the Son from the dead. The stone was rolled away. He came out victorious over death, hell, the grave, Satan, and everything that would be against you today. Amen. See, church, this is our hope. Our hope is not who's sitting in a White House across on the Potomac. Our hope is not found in our finances, our money. Our hope is not found in our retirement plans. Our hope is not found in our luxury. Our hope is found in Jesus Christ. For on Jesus, his shed blood is our hope. Not only hope in this world, because yes, there is hope. Whatever you're going through, facing and encountering, whatever you are going through right now in life, it's pulled you down to defeat. Let me tell you what, Jesus has given you hope. Hope that no weapon formed against you can prosper. Hope that whatever people say, think about you does not matter. Whatever is going on in your life, there is a God greater than whatever you are in. We have hope. And that hope is in Jesus. He triumphed over death in a human body. Truth number four, glorification. 40 days later, he ascended up into heaven. And today he is seated at the right hand of God the Father, interceding for you and for I. All of this tells us you're going to be all right. Because Jesus is talking to God on your behalf. Man, I'm glad I've got one who has never lost a case representing me before the court of heaven. Amen. Praise God. Now the promises. Man, this is good. Promise number one, his presence. He is with you always to comfort you. In the valleys of the shadows, he is with you. In the trials of life, he is with you. In the dark nights, he's with you. In the decisions you've got to make, he's with you. In the places that you're hurting and you're suffering and you're going through pain, oh, he's with you. Let me tell you what, whatever you're in and whatever you're going through, he is with you today. His presence has never failed, nor will it ever fail you, because he's a God who is a present help in time of trouble. Amen. He's present for conviction. He is present for change in your life. He is present to give you confidence. He is present to give you Christian composure, that when the world is falling apart, you're not. So what are we afraid of then? We're living in a nation and a world that's saturated and overwhelmed and overcome by fear. But the Lord of God says that God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power, love, and of a sound mind. Amen. Amen. Fear not, for I am with you. Fear not. Be of good cheer. Amen. I sit here this morning, watch some of you come in here, and you would have thought your world was crumbling at your very feet. The corners of your mouth were drooped to your kneecaps. I could see defeat, discouragement. I could see issues in your life that are worrying you, troubling you. Have you forgotten that Jesus said, "Fear not, for I'm with you"? You need to take the corners of your mouth and turn them up in the upward position to give praise to God. And stop walking around defeated and discouraged. That's not a witness for God. Amen. Let people know you're not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. Let this world know you have a hope that is found in Jesus. Amen. Praise God. Promise number two, provision. Take the bread and eat, he said. He gives you provision of strength in the storms of life that you have faced and you shall face. His provision is his nourishment to sustain you in the struggle. Amen. You are sustained. Amen. Oh, I love the way the Word of God declares it. Taste of the Lord and see that He is good. Amen. Promise number three, fellowship. When we're in Christ, He is always with you. Amen. You're never alone. We are close to Him, which makes us then close to one another in Christ. Promise number four, security. I love that word. The promise and security is that the gift of God is eternal life in Jesus Christ. What a promise. What a security. Thank God no one can pluck me out of the hand of the Father. Amen. I am in the hand of the Father, and I'm sealed by the Holy Spirit, and I'm covered by the blood, and no force in hell, on earth, or anywhere can pluck me out of the Father's hand. Amen. He's taken the wages of sin. He's taken the strength and the very sting of sin. He defeated it. And all that has come through Him today. Amen. Yes, there is life in Jesus. Live it! Regardless of what the world is doing, regardless of what anyone else is doing, live the life that Christ has called you to. Amen. Amen. Secondly, there's forgiveness in Jesus. There is a mechanism of how God forgives people. It's not going into a little room with a screen and a curtain and you talking to a father dressed like mother sitting behind the screen and supposedly atoning for your sin. There is no man on this earth that can forgive your sin except the man Christ Jesus. Amen. Amen. This is explained in verses 23 and 24. Jesus gives grace. G-R-A-C-E. God's riches at Christ's expense. You're only saved by God's grace, and it's all through Jesus. Grace is a gift. It's a gift for the forgiveness that God offers. Also, it's grace through faith. You got to believe by faith. None of you in this room or watching saw Jesus die on the cross. None of you saw Him come out of the grave. None of you saw Him ascend back into heaven. How do you believe that? You believe it by faith and through grace. Faith is believing what God has said and what Jesus has done. So grace, faith, and reconciliation, because reconciliation is a gospel word. Where we were strangers, enemy, alienated, separated from God, Jesus, through the ultimate sacrifice, brought us to the Father. And you know what He said when He brought you to the Father? Father, this one belongs to us. Hallelujah. Further, Jesus is our substitutionary atonement. God, hear me, God killed Jesus the Son so He wouldn't have to kill you and I. Amen. Jesus makes all things new. Get that. Third, and in closing, Jesus, I'm glad there's hope in Jesus today. You don't have to be afraid of the culture in which we're living in today. This world is not our home. There's a King who is waiting for us, who is throwing a feast, so when we get home, we're going to a marriage supper that, my dear friend, is going to be stretched across the heavens, and seated at the center of the table will be the Redeemer of all mankind, Jesus Christ, crowned with glory and praise. And we shall be sitting around that table, but you know, in that glorified state of being with Him, it'll be like we're sitting right next to Him. You realize you're seated right next to Him now. He is in you. Oh, He's on you. He is working through you. He is doing something in you that you can affect change in someone else's life. There's hope in Jesus. There's a clear end coming. And there's a day coming when we will stand before His throne. Hallelujah. When we're covered with the righteousness of Jesus, the righteous judge will say to you and to myself, well done. That should be the words that resonate in your spirit that you desire for Him to say. This should be the heartbeat of your life. Every day and every deed, every thought, every action, every word, everything about you should be centered around to hear Him say, well done. And there's a happy reward awaiting for those who are faithful of Christ. If you had to stand before Him today, and it could happen, what would you have said to you by Jesus? Will it be a happy day for you? You realize right now, in all the craziness of this world, you can still have a happy and blessed day. You're just preparing for what is to come. And if you'll get a joyful spirit in you, I'll tell you what, it won't be such a shock to you when you get there. So you need to start praising God. You need to start lifting your heart and your arms and your praise up to God in thanksgiving and giving Him glory for what He has done. Listen, this world is sad. You are born again, child of God, redeemed by the Lamb and the blood of Jesus. You're no longer defeated, down and out. Bless God, you've been lifted up, brought out, and you belong to God. You have a song to sing and a joy to give and a praise to give out God before His throne. Don't wait till you get there. Start doing it now. Do it now. Give Him glory, for He's worthy of our praise. It's only for those who have believed and received Christ, and there is life in Jesus. And today, if you're lost, you can be saved. For there is forgiveness for you. And let me tell you what, if there's things in your life that needs to be forgiven, even after salvation, you need to confess it. Jesus awaits your call. He waits for you at these altars before you. There's hope in Jesus, because if life has you down, defeated and discouraged, you can have hope and life in Him. You can look to Jesus, and Jesus will. He will make all things new. Amen. Praise God.